My coverage of CES 2024 is brought to you by Cooler Master, Kioxia, Asus, and Gigabyte. Hey guys, I'm over at Kioxia. They are a sponsor for my CES 2024 coverage, so a big thank you to them for helping me bring all the videos I've been bringing to you guys. We're going to talk about some different stuff today because Kioxia's specialty is, of course, making memory-based products, NAND flash memory. They have lots of storage and they're really, really good at it. But as a result, their primary audience is actually the enterprise market, which I only dabble in from time to time. So I'm going to bring in some outside help to help explain some of the stuff we're going to look at today. And one of the really cool and exciting things is they're sending SSDs to space. My guest is right over here. This is Cameron from Kioxia, and he has agreed to explain a lot more about their new SSDs. These are enterprise SSDs here, and we have some interesting information about like SSD form factors in the enterprise space, as well as I think at least one or two of these are the ones that will be going to space. But first, what are the new drives and how are they better than the old drives, I guess?
The new drives are going to be ones that are based on the PCIe Express 5.0 interface.
Okay.
So that'll give you twice the performance you can get from PCIe Gen 4. And the ones that are Gen 5 in this case here are the CM7, and you can see two versions of it. One is your typical U.2 or 2.5 inch, and the other is an E3.S variant, which is a brand new form factor. Then right next to that, we have the CD8P, also in E3.S, as well as 2.5 inch form factor. And then the XD7P, which kind of looks like an M.2 in a case, but it is a new form factor called E1.S. And that case is actually a heatsink.
Okay, so for the new form factors, this old form factor you were telling me before is designed for hard drives, and the newer form factors are designed for flash memory and can take advantage of flash memory requiring less space and also not requiring as much heat dissipation. Is that correct?
Yes. You're absolutely correct that the form factor was designed for hard drives, and when flash memory became used in those form factors, they just kept the form factor the same, and just since there are so many slots for them. But the new E3.S form factors were designed solely around NAND flash chips, and they are optimized for the dimensions are optimized for NAND flash. The E3.S are designed to replace the 2.5 inch form factor, and the E1.S is designed to replace the M.2 form factor.
So when we're talking about enterprise usage, data centers, that sort of implementation, just by virtue of these drives being skinnier, you can fit more of them in a single server rack?
Yes, exactly. The density that you can get within a server in a rack is going to be higher with E3.S. There are actually multiple variants of E3.S that you can get twice the thickness and make them longer, but the most common form factor version is going to be the E1.S, at least for today.
So as far as capacity and throughput for the newest drives, what are we looking at? Like on the consumer side, we're used to maybe 2 terabyte, 4 terabyte drives. What do these go up to?
Well, the largest ones can go up to 30.72 terabytes in a single drive. And that's going to be in the 2.5 inch form factor for now. In the new E3.S, the maximum capacity is going to be 15.36 terabytes.
And I believe you had mentioned that the old form factor, there was a limit to how many you could fit versus the new form factor.
Well, in a typical 2U system, you vertically orient the drives, and when you put the 2.5 inch form factor drives in, you can commonly get up to 24. But with the E3.S, you can get up to, I think it's 33 or maybe even 34 drives in a single server.
So we're talking like ballpark 50% more drives that can fit in there.
Yes.
Ballpark, of course.
It depends on your exact capacity per drive, okay, and things like that.
First off, it's really cool that some of these drives are going to be going to space. Not these drives that we're looking here, but some of the similar models that we're looking at here. Why is Kioxia sending drives to space? For what purpose and through what program?
Kioxia is working very closely with Hewlett Packard Enterprise on their Spaceborne Computer 2 project, and they're sending two servers in a NASA-specific form factor into the International Space Station. Kioxia is providing SSDs. We're actually providing SAS SSDs, which is a long-standing, very mature enterprise technology, which has been around many years before NVMe Express, but we're sending those drives in one of the servers, and in four of the drives are actually going to be in 30 terabyte capacity points, and the other version is going to be in 1 terabyte capacity points. So if for SAS, we're sending over 124 terabytes of storage space to the International Space Station.
And is that the PM7 driver, the previous variant of that?
PM6, which is the previous version of a 24 gig SAS interface.
And that's because I believe this is the case. NASA would prefer to go with something that has a little bit longer track record.
The experiment is not only for running experiments on the servers being used on the International Space Station. Utilizing off-the-shelf drives allows you to test the drives themselves in outer space.
NASA wasn't just looking for storage for their servers in the ISS. They actually want to test those drives to see how they perform up there. You also mentioned that this isn't the first time this has been done.
No, some SSDs actually have gone into space many years ago, and under the same premise, to see how they would behave in the harsh conditions of outer space.
Those were SATA SSDs, I believe, around 2016 you had mentioned.
Yeah, something like that.
They actually failed for an interesting reason?
Some of them failed, not all of them, but some of them failed due to the use of tantalum capacitors for power loss protection.
Which is just fine to use those kinds of capacitors here on Earth, but not necessarily up in space. But those aren't even regularly
used anymore
in SSDs anyway. So apart from the four PM6 drives that are going up, there's some additional drives going as well?
Yes, the PM6, there's another version of a SAS drive that we have called RM, which is called Value SAS, which is meant to be more like a SATA drive. Lower cost, single port, but again, it's also much more reliable than SATA.
Okay, so with the four 30 terabyte drives, four additional, those were going to be 1 terabyte drives for that version?
Yes. Then we have an additional NVM Express drive, our XG8. This is actually a client drive, which is going to be used in one of the servers. There's going to be 8 of those populating one of the edge servers.
And I think that's really funny because I've used the XG8 like in several of my benchmarking rigs over the past year. So it's cool that a same M.2 drive that I've used like to run gaming tests on like an RTX 4090, they're also going to be using in the ISS.
Yes.
And total is going to be over 130 terabytes worth of storage from Kioxia that's going to be going up there. And that is, I believe, a record at this point.
We're trying to validate this, but that may be the most amount of storage ever put into space.
That's impressive. I'm sure there'll be more storage going into space eventually, but it's nice to be like a market leader in that category.
Yes.
Alongside, of course, all of the great stuff you guys do for enterprise customers. There is one other thing we wanted to show you guys, apart from the new enterprise SSDs down here and the cool stuff going on with the space station, and that is a quick look at not the 7th gen, but the next generation, the 8th generation of BiCS flash storage. And for that, we have a couple demos over here. Let's head that way. I like visual aids. So here we have 3 visual aids showing how flash memory has been designed in the past. So the old way was this way. This is the cell array. This is basically the storage on the left, and then sort of the
peripheral circuitry.
Peripheral circuitry for controlling and accessing the storage.
Right, and connecting that to the host.
Okay. And then that has been more recently updated to this version, which is CUA.
CMOS under array.
So here you can see that memory cell array is up on top, which the multiple layers of storage. This is not the current number of actual layers of storage that they have. They're going up to 218 layers with 8th gen, but then the CMOS part of that whole configuration is down underneath. And what a great acronym, CUA, CMOS under the array.
Right.
Perfect.
Right.
All right, so what is new and special, and how does it help to have this new variant, which is CBA?
Yes, CBA stands for CMOS directly bonded to the array. And in this instance, even though the cell array is on top, like CUA, and the CMOS peripheral circuitry is underneath, they are manufactured in separate processes.
Okay.
This allows each of the different components, the cell array and the CMOS portion, to be developed and optimized independently before bonding them together.
So this is the bonding layer here. The darker blue on the bottom is going to be one half. Upper part is going to be the other half. Mm-hmm. They can be manufactured independently and then bonded together?
Yes, which gives you higher performance, better reliability, and higher yields.
Yields.
Improved yields.
So being able to manufacture those both independently means that you can have a little bit more tighter control over each half of it, improved yields, and also you can optimize to make sure that the process node that's being used for each part is going to be the most efficient way of manufacturing that. Again, to use some somewhat precise and somewhat vague terms, which is what we're trying to do here.
Yeah, improve yields means you get more good chips out of each wafer.
That's good for the manufacturer and theoretically good for the consumer as well, assuming some of those savings are passed on. But it's a commodity market, so we're just going to assume that. I won't ask Cam for his actual direct feedback.
My lips are sealed.
So here's the infographic on the 8th generation Kioxia BiCS flash 3D flash memory. And I'm just gonna quickly sort of scan down this for any of you guys who are absolutely fascinated by this. The thing that fascinates me the most is when it comes to NAND flash, that's what we're looking at. That's like a module right there. And the fact that they now have modules that are 1 terabit in capacity.
2 terabits.
And actually with the 8th generation, you see 1 terabit there. 8th gen is going to be 2 terabit in capacity for just one module. They also have the improvements with the 8th generation listed right here. 60% interface speed improvement up to 3.2 gigabits per second, and that is per module. 20% improved write performance, 10% read latency improvement, 30% power efficiency improvement, and 50% higher bit density. Cam also mentioned earlier to me that Kioxia is fairly conservative when it comes to actually releasing speeds and feeds for the products that they're designing. So they're incredibly confident that these numbers are accurate with the 8th generation. And it's going to be a great improvement both for NAND flash storage in terms of capacity, as well as, I imagine, eventually affordability for people as this trickles down to the rest of the market. Again, a little bit more for the infographic here. I also thought it was interesting to see the various BGA packages that are currently supported, 132 BGA, 152, and 154. And although it is just sort of a picture representation, there you can see the layer count going up to 218. It's not necessarily all about the layers though, as Cam was also mentioning to me earlier. It's also about density. And by increasing the actual area of the NAND chip itself, increasing the amount of bits per layer, you can actually get more storage with fewer layers. And that's actually going to be much more optimal for you. You want to get as much storage as possible, of course, but in as few layers as possible. That's better for longevity. And here's one last look at the CUA technology over here with the CMOS under the array versus CBA right here with two independently manufactured parts of the eventually completed cell array right there with the CMOS on the bottom and the cell array on top. So I want to say a big thank you to Cam for sharing that information with us today because he did a much better job of explaining it than I would have. Also, a big thank you to Kioxia for sponsoring my coverage of CES 2024. If you guys enjoyed this video, let us know down in the comment section below. If you're like an enterprise, like memory nerd, I'd especially like to hear from you because you probably know more about this stuff than I do. And if any of this really excites you, let me know in the comment section down below. Also, a big thank you to my additional sponsors for CES 2024, Gigabyte, Asus, and Cooler Master. I do have more videos coming at you real soon, so hit the subscribe button. Check out the playlist if you haven't already. Check out my store at pulsehardware.net if you want to buy some nice merch. And we'll see you guys in the next video. Nice merch. That's
merch.
That's how I like to describe it.